vibration that unites in love and peace. Our lighted candle symbolizes the Christ light presence in all. My name, in case you don't know me, is Terry Whitey. And if anyone has cell phones turned on, please put them on mute. Anything else I need to? Do not so much. Let's read our mission statement and then follow that with the vision statement. The Center for Universal Oneness is a place where those who want support on their spiritual journey may join with others for mutual encouragement, inspiration, and guidance. The Center draws on those practices based in new thought and metaphysical approaches. The higher Christ consciousness provides the foundation. We strive to live in the oneness of love. Vision statement.
Have to say, I am so excited. I could spin right off the floor. Someone like me. No.
Go ahead.
I got to meet Teresa Friday, and I fell in love. Jeff, don't be worried. It's not that kind of love. But we were just in for such a treat. So anyway, her talk today is about the shaman journey, and I must admit I knew very little. Well, honestly, I knew nothing about it. So I did a little research so that our prayer could be relevant. And what I found out, and maybe lots of you know this, I don't know, but what I found out was that it is an old tribal heritage that is practiced by indigenous people across the world. And what they have in common is communication with spirit and nature and an ability to connect with their creator. So with that in mind, I went out to look for a prayer that I thought would be relevant to that. And what I found out was that some of the shaman prayers, and I hope I'm right, Teresa, connect with spirits from different directions, north, south, east, west. Well, we're facing west, and so my prayer today is to the spirit facing west. Great spirit of the west, spirit of the great waters of river, lakes, springs, and rains, great grandmother ocean, deepest matriarch, womb of all life. With you comes the dissolving of boundaries and of limitations, the power to taste, feel, cleanse, and heal. Great blissful darkness of peace, we humbly ask that we may be aligned with you, that your prayer may flow through us for the good of this earth and all living things upon it. Amen.
It is now my pleasure to introduce Peggy Chilson, who's been with us quite a few times now. Going to lead us in song in a moment. My bio says, Peggy Chilson is a busy and versatile vocalist in the Kansas City area, entertaining and inspiring audiences with her warm, fluid tone. Hear her jazz vocal trio this Wednesday, the 22nd, is that correct?
That's old.
Let's see, the third Wednesday of August.
Okay.
It's not quite August yet, but whatever that date is.
Okay.
You continue. 5:30 to 7:30
at California's.
Yeah.
Passport.
Oh. Yeah.
Very good. As well as several New Thought services in the area. Thank you.
I have journeyed
And now we're going to have another very lovely person, Teresa Hubbard, who is going to give us a presentation on shamanic dream. And let's see. Teresa Hubbard is a licensed mental health clinician. She lives and works in Liberty. Teresa is passionate about experiencing different ways to help us find healing, sharing those experiences, and sharing those experiences with others. She owns the Kansas City Neuroplasticity Institute, say that 50 times fast, which focuses on providing neurofeedback services in treatment of a wide range of health concerns, and also a retreat and wedding venue called The Journey Home. So, thank you for being here.
I get to turn Teresa on.
And we get to watch.
Well, that's great. Don't be in the video.
Never have your back to the video.
Now I am worried.
Is this working?
Yes.
Okay, good. Thanks for having me. I'll start out with saying that I don't like presenting at all. I like having a dialogue. And so for me, this is uncomfortable. So what I want to say is before we actually do the meditation, if you have questions about the process, I want you to ask. Because I want it to be beneficial to you. And so I'm delivering, you know, this from my lens, but it doesn't mean that it's going to reach all of you. And so if there are things that you're not sure about, just ask me before we get started. Because I want it to be nice and relaxing for you. So thank you for the prayer. It was beautiful. It was, and the four directions in the sun and the moon, and it's beautiful. It was very touching. I was teary while listening to it. So I brought a prayer too that typically, so my training, Elizabeth put on the back, is with Hank Westman and his wife, Jill Kirkendall. And I've done three levels of the shamanic journey and training. And so I am allowed to teach level one, and which is what Elizabeth and Carolyn over there, like, where'd she go, did with me last year. And it is a lovely process. So we're doing about 30 minutes of week one in this process. So I did my best to condense it so that it makes sense. So so we're going to start with the prayer that normally we would start with. I have not memorized it in the old Hawaiian language, but I want to. But I'm going to read it in English. It is a beautiful prayer. So go ahead and close your eyes for just a moment. Great spirits, ancestral immortals, spirits of nature, you who stand before us and behind us, on our right and on our left, from the zenith to the horizon, from the sun's rising to the sun's setting, blessings on our sacred lands, blessings on our sacred oceans, blessings on our homes, and blessings on all of you. Ancestral immortals, great spirits of nature, continue to bring forth from the spirit world the water of life. Continue to bring forth the gifts of good health and abundance to all without limit, and manifest these blessings free of all restriction. Our prayers have been lifted. They are free. So what is journeying? journeying is an experience of an intentional meditation. The one we're doing today is the one that all of his training starts with. We call it the Sacred Garden. So before we get started, we will set an intention. I'll give you general direction. And then whatever you create in your mind's eye, it's all yours. There is no expectation that they should be a similar experience. There is no right or wrong about it. It is, from a brainwave perspective, we are with the drumming, and I did bring a rattle too. I'm not going to do the rattling because it isn't something that speaks to most people, but I wanted you to be able to hear it in case, as I did it for just a moment, you're like, oh, that actually, I like that better, because there are rattling CDs as well. But as we do the drumming, the point of the music is to help your brain induce what's called our theta brainwave state. Theta is the brainwave that we want most in charge when we are in deep meditation or prayer. And so when you go, you know, when you sink down into that space and there's stillness, that's theta. And so the drumming is to help us get there. But it can take a while. I mean, it's not automatic. Some people drop into it automatically. Some people have a lot of theta naturally. Everybody's brain waves function at different levels, and so it just takes practice, your body getting used to the drumming. And there are wonderful drum CDs out there. I am going to play the drum today because it's nice to have it played for you. The journeying process is about shaping our subconscious. And so when we go into the Sacred Garden today, there'll be images that come up for you. So the journeying process is us being more aware of what's in our subconscious, just in this particular place, our sacred garden, and then shaping it. But we're shaping it with nature, animals, water, fire, from a symbolic perspective. And so as you change your garden, as you add things, let's say you wanted to add a fire pit, it's not there, you know, when you first get started, but you're like, I would like one of those. Your process about why you added the fire can come later. That doesn't need to be during the journey. It's just, oh, I would like a fire here in my sacred garden, so you add it. And so the belief around it is that you, as you add or take things away, that you are shaping your subconscious. You could be bringing in peace or unconditional love or resilience by, you know, the symbols that you bring in. It is a beautiful process. You can also take things away as well. So let's say you are in your garden and we're doing the meditation and there's a swamp there. And you're like, why is there a swamp in my garden? Well, you can ask for help from your sacred garden helpers. And you can say, help me drain this swamp. I would like the swamp to go. And then you can plant whatever you would like there. So one of the stories that Hank tells is he was doing a level one with a group, and a woman afterwards was in a lot of distress because her garden, while it was beautiful, was overrun with vines. And so he had her work on having helpers come in and help her remove the vines. And so she spent weeks doing journeys just to have helpers come in and continue to remove the vines. And for her specifically, it was connected to her cancer journey. And as she continued to remove the vines in her journeying process, her body was healing. And so it's just a powerful process, but very different and unique. It varied. That's all I can say. It is. I mean, you just don't know what's going to show up. Sometimes things that are very unusual they catch you off guard. You know, the belief that our connection with nature and source is our most healing places we can be. That's why the focus is so much around nature. It's like creating a visionary window, like your vision board, but in regards to nature and symbols, our connection to the universe. So why would we journey? I would say for me, journeying is about creating space. I now can meditate, sit still, be in silence, drop down, but I couldn't do that for years. Meditation was very difficult. It was discouraging, it was disheartening, it was frustrating. Having created an expectation in my head of what the process needed to be like to create space for myself. And shamanic journeying was just one of the ways that I trained my body to be able to do that. And so there were a lot of things that I worked on. this was a nice way to help train my body to be still. So what might the experience be like for you? It is so hard for us to not create an expectation of what it should be like. And you read books about it. You'll read a lot of stories about the amazing things people see, and sometimes you do. Sometimes they are full of color and vivid and like a movie, and it's amazing. And sometimes you fall asleep. And sometimes you're like, did I see something in my like eye? Could that come back? You know, it's like this glimpse of something. And sometimes it's very faded and gray. And it is just not the same every time. So again, when you read about it, you may read these amazing things people see, but it isn't always like that. And so to not be discouraged in the process. So just hang in there. You know, and sometimes for people, it's about feeling it. Some people don't see things at all, but maybe they feel overwhelming love or peace or grief, releasing grief, weeping. So where we're going today. Today we're going into what Hank Musselman and many teachers talk about is the middle world. And so the middle world is about being grounded right here on this planet. So the upper world in shamanic journeying is like our connection to source, angels. It's a place of learning, so like downloading higher consciousness when you travel to the upper world. And then the lower world is our connection to all sentient beings, and I would say even wider than that, real and extraordinary. And so you could meet, you know, a unicorn in the lower world, or talking worm in the lower world, or you know, it's a very unique process. And even in the beginning of the journey, you enter that through a hole in a tree, or a hole in the ground, or imagine yourself walking down into the earth, or diving into water. And so that it's just a different process of entering the different worlds. And so today we're just doing the middle world. It's just a nice place to start, to get grounded. So I'm going to give you the process, and then what the rules are, according to Hank, when you're there in the middle world. And then I'll have you close your eyes and we'll get started. So you're going to bring into your mind a place in nature. And if anything comes to you right now, it's fine. Because it doesn't mean that it's going to be what comes to mind when you actually close your eyes and you start drumming. So don't get frustrated as best you can. So bringing into your mind a place where you can connect with nature. And it can be a place you have been, and it can be a place that you want to be, and maybe haven't, like, you know, like, I want to go to Hawaii, but I've never been to Hawaii. And if that's what comes, it's good. And so it's not like you have to have been there. It's just something that feels connected. Sometimes you can watch a movie, like, Where the River Runs Through It, and you're like, whoa, I want to go there, but you haven't been there, and that's okay. But it spoke to your body, and so whatever comes up is just fine. So Hank calls it your sacred garden. So you're going to imagine yourself there. You're going to feel it. Notice the temperature, the time of day, the smells. Are you barefoot? What do you see? What can you touch? So bringing in all the sensory piece. Does it feel safe there? It's called your sacred garden. Sometimes it feels safe. Sometimes it's anxiety producing. So just notice everything you can about yourself in that space. Hearing the birds, feeling the wind on your skin. So his four rules, rule number one. Everything in your garden is symbolic. Symbolic of you or some aspect of you. So a great oak tree could be symbolic of your own inner strength and resilience. Water could be peace. And at the end, just so you know, there'll be a few minutes where we won't say anything once the drumming stops. And if you want to take notes right then, you can do that. On your phone, whatever, it doesn't matter. feel free to write something down if it comes to you that you want to hold on to. The rule number two, you can communicate with everything that's in your garden. Everything. You can talk to trees and birds, stones and animals, and they communicate back to you. So that beautiful amethyst crystal that's sitting next to your fire pit can give you a message. Part of the practice of journeying is learning to listen. There's always messages. Rule number three, we talked about this, you can change your garden. Conjuring up whatever you want. Again, taking away, asking for help, one of the hardest things for us to do. Ask for help, they will come. Your helpers will come. And then the last rule, when you change your garden, some aspect of you in your life will change in return. This is intentional. I mean, you are working to change your subconscious and how it sees your sacred space. So, from an energetic perspective, some people struggle with journeying because they feel like you're opening yourself up to evil by being that open. And so how Hank addresses that is as soon as the drumming starts and you close your eyes, you ask your source, your God, your guides to set your vibration high enough that nothing from a lower vibration can come in and mess with you or manipulate your space. And so ask for that. Okay. So the beat, as we do it, is quick. And so doing it with a rattling CD, it would be very fast. And the most of the guided meditations or the drumming and the rattling is anywhere from 12 to 20 minutes. There are ones that are longer, but that's enough time for most people to have an experience. And so I'll be drumming, and what will happen is I will, right towards the end, so we're going to do it for about 10 minutes so we have time for some quiet and to finish by quarter till. And so about a minute before we're going to finish, I'm going to stop the drumming for just a moment, and then I'm going to beat the drum even more quickly. And that more quickly beat is the signal for your subconscious to come back. So say goodbye, wish your garden well, and then return. And so, and then when I stop drumming completely, then you can take just a minute or two to just feel that, process for just a moment what your experience was. Then we'll be done. So go ahead and close your eyes. Get comfortable, both feet on the floor, if you can do that. And allow your thoughts to settle. Bring up an image of your garden. Allow it to come alive. As you listen to the sound of the drum, which will begin to fade into the background. Smell the smells. Feel what's around you. Notice the colors, the shapes, the textures. Notice what you feel in your body. Rest in your garden. Do some exploring. Do a little garden work. Knowing that this is a place of inner power and healing. Take a couple of deep, clearing breaths. Allow your jaw to relax. Allow your hands to relax. Allow your back and shoulders to relax. And just allow whatever happens to happen. Thank you.
of some Native American workshops we did many years ago.
Flip your mic on.
It's on top.
There we go. So, one more time. Thank you very much. Very meditating, very well. It is now time for the offering. Baskets will be passed on both sides, and thank you for your gifts. And if you would, let's say our offering prayer. Divine love, through me, blesses and multiplies all that I have, all that I give, and all that I receive, and I am joy-filled and grateful. Concerns anyone would like to share and that we can pray about now and through the week? No community concerns?
What is happening?
I'd like the community to hold my brother David in their prayers. He continues to have some medical issues, and it's been a long, tiring road for him to address those. David, in your prayers, I appreciate it. Also, there is one of the people that have come to speak to us on a number of occasions is having a very difficult time with depression. And I would like for you to keep Kelly in your prayers as well.
Mom has been dealing with some sciatica stuff, and it's impacting her 97-year-old lifestyle. She's not liking it. I mean, would like prayers for healing so that she can be happy and healthy.
Anyone else? No one? Okay. Then let's say our prayer for community concerns. Centering our hearts and minds in prayer, we let go of any thoughts of worry or challenge and simply rest in the stillness. We know that our source of strength and peace comes from God alone. We give thanks for divine order and trust that we are all held in the power of grace. Next Sunday, we welcome Kara Quigley as our speaker, and John Hardesty as our musician. And thanks again to Peggy Chilson for the wonderful music.
Yay.
And Teresa Hubbard for the drumming and the shamanic journeying.
Yay! Woo-hoo.